Hello and welcome to this edition of Curator with a Camera. I'm Anthony Coulls, Senior Curator at the National Railway Museum, and we're here at Locomotion to look at the Fireless Locomotive Imperial No. 1. Imperial No. 1 is a fireless steam locomotive. It was made in 1956, right as diesel and electric locomotives were coming into mainstay in shunting yards all across the country. Well, the concept of a fireless engine has been around since the 19th century. And the first challenge to the traditional coal, coke, or wood-burning steam locomotive came with the creation of the Metropolitan Railway, which became the Underground. Of course, it's no good having a steam locomotive in tunnels under central London, spewing out ashes and fumes and smoke. So an engineer called John Fowler, later Sir John Fowler, came up with the idea of a steam locomotive which had both a firebox and then a chamber full of fire bricks, so that when the engine went into the tunnels, these fire bricks would be so hot that the heat from the fire bricks would continue to make steam for as long as the engine was driving through the tunnels. It gained the nickname Fowler's Ghost, and I'm afraid to say it was the most spectacular failure ever. But Fowler's idea, Fowler's concept of stored energy was taken up by other people, not in the UK, but on the continent. A company called Orenstein and Koppel made a lot of fireless engines throughout the late 19th century, early 20th century. But the idea was only really taken up by one major UK manufacturer, and that is Andrew Barclay and Sons of Kilmarnock. So why a fireless engine? What is it and how does it work? Why no chimney? Why no coal bunkers? Why no fire within the engine itself to make steam? Well, steam engines with a fire are what we might term external combustion engines. The ignition, the combustion, takes place in a firebox, usually at the end of an engine towards the cab, and the gases from the fire pass through a boiler to a smoke box at the far end, and they heat the water. Now, the problem with the steam engine with a fire in its box is that it can drop cinders and ashes out onto the track, and depending on the fuel or how hard the engine is working, it can throw sparks and cinders out of the chimney. That's all very good and atmospheric, but it's not particularly helpful if you're working in a hazardous environment. So the fireless engine came into use really in the UK around 1912, and they were made for military installations, they were made for food places, they were made for paper mills, wood yards, timber yards, anywhere where the danger and risk of ashes from under the loco or sparks out of the chimney would have presented an ignition and combustion hazard. So the Germans patented the idea of a fireless engine, and what happens in a fireless engine is that it is charged up with steam. This is not a boiler, this is a reservoir. It's like a big battery. It's stored energy is put into this reservoir. And here on the front is the valve that the engine will be plugged into a steam supply to enable it to operate. This engine worked at the Imperial Paper Mills at Gravesend in Kent. Paper making process uses a lot of steam. There's a lot of steam throughout the plant, so they had a number of charging stations where the fireless locos could be pretty much plugged in, as an electric car would be now. Now, first off, boiling water is piped into the engine, and then that is followed by very high pressure steam, up to about 200, 220 pounds per square inch. And after a couple of hours, the reservoir is full, about two-thirds full of water, and then steam on top of that. Then what happens to that steam? That valve is shut off, the charging hose is disconnected, and this is a stored energy vessel. That is then connected very much as a conventional steam engine. The regulator valve to control the admission of steam to the cylinders is up there in a dome, and then goes through a pipe through down to the steam cylinders. Between the regulator and the cylinders is a thing called a reducing valve, and that reducing valve takes the workable steam pressure in the cylinders down to about 80 pounds per square inch. It actually means the engine operates for longer and it doesn't lose power as the pressure drops. As the pressure inside the reservoir goes down, so the boiling point of the water also lowers, and the water boils again, making more steam. So that water reserve in it continues to help the engine to operate until such time that the pressure in the reservoir is around the same as the pressure going to the cylinder, so around 80 pounds per square inch, and then it's time to recharge your reservoir and plug it in, and here we go again. The actual mechanics of the fireless engine are very, very conventional. We have a pair of steam cylinders at the back, very heavily lagged and insulated because you don't want to lose steam energy, heat energy to the air. So these are really quite tightly lagged. And as with so many of our other engines, connected via piston rod to a connecting rod down to the four driving wheels, which makes this an 040 locomotive. And inside the frames, there is the valve gear, very much standard Stevenson motion, as we found on bauxite and copper knob and so many of the other engines in our collection. But you look at most conventional locomotives and these cylinders are under the front end. Why does the fireless look like this? Well, it's for two reasons. One, we go back to the need for efficiency with the fireless engine, and the steam passage from the dome to the cylinders being as straightforward as possible. So it doesn't need to go via the smoke box. It doesn't need to go via a convoluted steam circuit. Apart from that reducing valve, it's straight from the regulator down to the cylinders there. But also practically, if you think about a steam locomotive, a conventional steam locomotive, the cylinders are at the front and the weight distribution of them is balanced by the mass of a firebox, the weight of a firebox at the back of the frames. So by having the cylinders at the rear of the engine, it balances out the weight distribution on a fireless engine, because there is no firebox there, but there is the entire weight of the reservoir. Now, the more we look at the fireless engine, the more we can see little features that are designed to either conserve steam or even not use it at all. So what about this? This is something that you don't see on a UK loco very often, a bell. Actually, this one is most peculiar because it does have a whistle as well. Now, you don't want to be using a whistle, so you have a mechanical bell to conserve steam, but still have an audible warning that people can hear before the engine sets off in motion. But also, given the fact that it's in an industrial context and it's working hard at the paper mill 24 hours a day, production doesn't stop, we have quite a modern electric headlamp on it. No good having an oil lamp or a paraffin lamp, as many of the historic locos do in the collection. Moving to the back of the engine, it has what are known as dome buffers on the front and rear. These are made of several solid blocks of timber, quite often oak, faced with iron or steel there. There's no springing, but again, they just help the engine when it's coupling up to normal rolling stock there with the coupling hook. And then on the rear of the cab, how does the fireless engine get rid of the exhaust? Well, there's no chimney at the front, but the cylinders are at the rear, and so both cylinders exhaust through the steam chest into an exhaust pipe, which goes up the back of the cab through a silencer, that very large pot on the top, and then there's a little drain pipe there, which then comes down the back of the engine and drops down the bottom of the buffer beam onto the track itself. So what of the inside of a fireless engine? How do you drive it? Let's go and have a look. Now we're here in the cab of Imperial No. 1, it sounds a bit like we're in an echo chamber, and that's because there's so little in this engine compared to a conventional loco, the sound isn't deadened by all the fittings and fixtures and all the gizmos around it. And you're struck by the incredible simplicity of the area we're standing in. Not just how it's made, you can see quite clearly the run of weld from Mr. Barclay all around the edge, you know, really up-to-date production techniques. But what is there in here? Well, on a normal engine, a conventional steam locomotive, in front of me now would have been water gauge glasses, there'd be a firebox door, there'd be damper controls, there'd be all sorts of things, injectors, steam valve blower, lots of things that would help me operate the engine. But because this is, in essence, a big reservoir, a big battery, all we have is the very large end of the steam reservoir itself. And likewise, as with all of the steam locomotives, we have the regulator handle with open and closed, and there, just on the edge of it, Barclays or maybe Imperial Mills have helpfully stamped shut, so you know which way is closed and the thing won't go anywhere. At the back on the cab sheet there is our pressure gauge. I said when we were looking at the reservoir outside that we were talking sometimes up to 200 psi of steam that would be charged into this machine. You can see the red line there indicates that this engine will run on 160 pounds per square inch of steam. Now, absence of pipe work, no injectors, no blower, no steam brake, no vacuum brakes. So where do these pipes go? Well, that first one is the steam cock and the valve and the pipe for the pressure gauge. And then over here is another cock there with attendant pipe work going out through the front of the cab to the whistle. Of course, you don't want to use that very, very often. So here comes the fun bit. In the cab, in the roof, is not a piece of string, but like a button. And it's connected mechanically to our bell outside. And yeah, you could always say, I always wanted to do that. But that's one of the curator's perks, isn't it? What else have we got in here? There is another steam pipe coming off there and another pipe with a valve coming off there to a water gauge glass. Again, a feature seen on normal steam locomotives with a firebox. And this, along with the pressure gauge, will be giving our driver an indication of how much water he has left in the reservoir before he has to take the locomotive to a charging station, to a charging point, in order to top up the steam supply to the machine itself. But how do you stop the fireless engine? Now, a lot of industrial locomotives, later than bauxite, which we featured in Curator with a Camera, had steam brakes, they had a power brake. But with this machine, it's all about conserving energy, it's all about efficiency. So how you stop it, how you slow it down, there is a handbrake mechanism here, a ratchet. So you would pull the lever back against the ratchet, and the engine would slow down or stop. So this also doubles as your parking brake, so you can stop the engine and leave it where it needs to be. Most other locomotives in our collection have a rotary handbrake with a handbrake handle that goes around like that. This is Barclay's particular way of getting around the problem of having something that's a lot more controllable and out of the way. It's quite compact, it's quite nice. And then our last piece of equipment, which isn't really a control, is this rather fine brass displacement lubricator, which the top unscrews there, you fill it with steam oil and open this valve to a degree that you want it to. This then allows steam from this pipe to go down what's called, this is a dead leg displacement lubricator. Steam goes into here, condenses into water, and the oil is then forced out, and it will lubricate the cylinders, so the engine has a source of oil going to the pistons and the valves. Really, really basic. But then the whole machine is really basic because it's made to move trucks around, and that's what you get, a very, very plain basic machine for a very basic job. We've seen the fireless engine today inside and out. We've seen how effective, efficient, clean and quiet it is. So why hasn't it taken off anymore in the UK? Well, perhaps because it is a steam engine And by the 1950s, British Railways and industry surrounding and supplying it had made the decision that they were going to go for modern traction, diesel and electric, because it was clean. But what cleaner than this? There are no exhaust fumes. All that comes out of the exhaust at the back and the silencer is water vapor. And perhaps that's why in certain parts of Europe, fireless engines are still at work in electricity power stations, in chemical works, various places. And perhaps it will be that as a world strives for energy efficiency and cleanness and fewer emissions and carbon zero, the fireless engine will see a renaissance. Who knows? Thanks for joining us today for Curator with a Camera. If you've enjoyed our film today, why not like and subscribe so you don't miss out on further updates of Curator with a Camera.
Go.